Proud to be broadcasting from Cal State University, Long Beach. This is KKJZHD3FM, Long Beach, Los Angeles, and KBeach.org. You're hearing the future. This is KBeach Radio, and I am your host, Eddie F&D. We got a couple of homies in here. You guys want to go ahead and shout out?
What's up? Kickback Steve once again.
Hey, everybody. It's Drew. How you doing?
Welcome back. Another episode of High Vibes Radio. We got some stuff for you today. Not going to lie, we don't have some stuff for you today, but we're going to have a good time. And you know what? Just being honest out there, was able to finally finish Narcos. I was stoned out of my mind. And could I just say season 2 was epic, but low key, they've kind of finished it just like,
It's true to the story. They built it up how it was supposed to be built up, and it ended just like how it ended in real life.
Wow.
Wait. Wow. I haven't finished it, so.
No spoilers. But let me just say, that is such a good, like, way you said it. Just watch out for that. And, you know, if you guys haven't seen it yet, we got Smoke Session Pour number 3 on the YouTube. Check that out. You know, we just do a little video, smoke it. Nothing too fancy, no talking. It's just right to the point. And, when we were watching it, was me and Juby. We were thinking, man, he looked over at me and he's like, bro, we should put some like reggaeton music. And it was just right for the moment. So all you people out there right now, I'm going to blast you with some energy. I need some energy for sure. But like always, this is a moment right now to get in your space, get your fingers rolling a blunt, a joint. Are you packing a bowl? If not, you should be. And if you know, if you're one of those high ballers who can handle the THC, some wax, because some of y'all like that wax.
Maybe you just need to eat an edible and chill out today, bro. You know.
Yeah, exactly. You know what, man? Let's just be real. However you get high, right now is the time to get high, and we're gonna play a little bit of Daddy Yankee.
Gasoline. Daddy Yankee.
I hope hope you guys enjoy.
I'm about to lose it.
Suma de mambo pa' que mi gata prenda los motores. Que se prepare, que es lo que viene pa' que le den.
All right. What's up, everyone? I hope everyone here is having a beautiful day, beautiful night, whatever it is. Hope you guys are having a beautiful one. So, you know how it is. I like to give my sonas a little bit of what's going on in the world. Well, this episode I am. And something serious come up. I'm going to be real with everyone right now. Of course, I'm Latino. But realistically speaking, I've never been one to really feel like, oh, I'm Mexican or I'm Spanish. I've always felt more on the side of, you know, that Native American, you know, the like everything about Native Americans I love. And my coming to learn that my great grandfather was an actual native of Mexico, like he was a real native. He like knew the language, and there's something about coming from that culture and that background. It's just like I don't assimilate well to, like, you know, the quinceañeras and all that. But it's like if there's like a, you know, where they like beat the drum. I can't think what it's called.
Powwows.
It's just like that energy is just so attractive, and it's just like a spiritual difference. But you wanted to say something?
I was just gonna say, which part of Mexico is your great grandfather from?
Great great grandfather's from Burandido. I don't know like all like the details, so it's kind of just like I know Michoacan, the state. Mm-hmm. And so it's just cool that, you know, they were telling me like his language and all that. And what I really want to talk to you guys about honestly is the Dakota pipeline. I don't know if you guys heard about this, but basically I'm not too informed. I just found this out, so I'm trying to, you know, just inform you guys of what's going on in the U.S. But they're trying to build a pipeline through a reservation, and a lot of these Native American people are fighting this. People, Native Americans are coming from other states on freaking horseback. And it's crazy because it's like they're not just fighting for their life or their family or their land. They're fighting for all Americans. They're saying, hey, water is sacred, and if you build this pipeline, you're going to ruin it for everyone. And how much millions of dollars Americans have to spend on the cleanup afterwards? Because this is what they do. This is what pipelines come in. They say, hey, you know what? We're going to distribute it, you know, in the country. It's going to be all domestic, right? They'll say that. And then in their clauses and all that, or in their legal stuff, it'll say, you know, at this point, it'll be open for resale to someone else. And then at this point, it'll be open up for resale to someone else. And so all this domestic oil that they're saying will stay domestic isn't. And they're building a pipeline through our country with straight lies. And here we are, you know, once again, all over again, just like when it first happened hundreds and hundreds of years ago. Like Native American people are having their land stolen. And we're at a time where I feel that there's just too much available communication to not do something about it. So I wanted to go ahead and share that with you guys. Give me your thoughts, you guys. I want to know what's up. What do you guys think?
Well, for one, I think it's really screwed up. You know, they're put on reservations by the American government because their land was taken from them. So the fact that the land that they were given, because everything else was taken from, is already being destroyed again. But like we were talking about earlier, it's like at this point, we already know that the U.S. government is going to do whatever they want to do, regardless of who they hurt or who they affect. They're just going to continue to keep doing what they do to make money, because it's a big company at this point. We're the biggest corporation in the world, I'd say. You know what I mean? And in order to make your profits larger, you don't really care about who you're hurting or what you're destroying. So
it is just crazy because, you know, how is it that they get this far? You know what I mean?
Greed.
Yeah.
Like I think the power of greed is an unstoppable force. Like, I feel bad. Like we were saying earlier on the break, these people have been taken advantage of and stripped of all of their human rights. And we keep pushing the envelope with them. We keep taking away what little they have. And I was not trying to be a Debbie Downer. It's not what I'm here to do. But I was just being realistic when I said that there's kind of no point in being heated or hyped up about this, because they really have no choice. They're going to do what they want to do, especially to those people who really have no voice. There aren't a lot of them to, you know, kind of like join forces and combat.
But and see, that's why you know, I was saying earlier, like, this is the perfect time. We live in a point where we have social media. We have all these things going on. And there's how could we not do something about it. You know what I mean? And, you know, we'll just leave it at that right now. We'll go ahead and just take a quick break and just kind of come back from that. But
that was real heavy.
That's some real
it's
heavy
not heavy.
Stuff.
You know, it's just real. It's real. It's what it is. It's life. And we need to deal with it. So,
yeah. Cool. And two, I mean, let's be real. Like, that's for everybody. You know what I mean? Everybody's got is about water. Everyone needs water. So it's just, I don't know. But right now we're going to play some Bob Marley. Is This Love? I really hope you guys enjoy. And if anyone from Dakota, if anyone from that tribe is listening, which I hope this is for you guys. And I really, really back what you guys are doing. And if, you know, there's something I could do, I'll figure out a way to help you guys out with that for sure. Beyond the monetary, you know, something that I could help, because that's awesome. But Bob Marley, This Is Love. Some Bob Marley, Is This Love. All right, guys, we got a very, very special guest, as we always do. I'll go ahead and let you introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Bolony. My real name is Sonia, but if you know me, you know me as Bolony, because that's who I am. I am a canna baker and creator of Bobombitez, which is my edibles company. He's my little toddler baby. I started him 4 years ago. I was actually in college. I was doing event planning, and somewhere along the lines, I watched Weeds, and she made edibles. And I was like, wait, what? I can bake with weed? And that's a start.
And it just, your life.
It just, poof, mind blown, completely mind blown. It's an industry I love. Baking is something I love to do. I taught myself, and I redirected myself from hospitality industry to marketing just to grow him, Bob. That's the acronym, Bobombitez.
Wow. And yeah. So, your inspiration is just very admirable. Was it a lot of work? Like, what kind of work did you have to put in?
You know what? It's something I love to do. So it does. It never feels like work. Mm-hmm. It's literally just creating. It's I get in my kitchen and I just start because it's a home-based business. I have yet to expand into a commercial type of thing. And honestly, when I first started, I wanted to be in shops. I wanted to be in dispensaries. I wanted to be known by dispensaries. And along the line, I realized I don't need to. I want people to know me, my brand. I want people to know Bobombitez. Like you're saying, do you remember when? I love that. I love going on Instagram and seeing people posting stuff. So it's the work is not work. It just comes from the heart.
Yeah.
And it literally shows. I want to say that it shows into my edibles when you taste them, when you try them, when you have them. You're like, oh, there it is. The 420 love.
Yeah, that's what's up. It's cool, too, because I was talking to her and I was like, hey, do you remember me? And I awkwardly gave the date that I saw her because I knew. And she was like, oh, Kush Expo. And it was just like, awesome.
Yeah.
Full circle.
Awesome. Yes, exactly. Full circle. Exactly. I love that.
Now, you know how we like to do. We like to get to know our peoples. Mm-hmm. Now, tell us, you know, obviously the big starter question. What's your favorite strain?
Blue Dream. Oh, my God. I'm a sativa girl all the way through. I actually started with weed back in 2010. I used to suffer from depression. I was literally on Prozac. I had therapists and nothing helped. Nothing made it better. So somewhere along the line, my husband now introduced me to weed, and I didn't know there were strains. I didn't even know what weed was like. Mm-hmm. I really thought it was a little five leaf thing that's what it was. So he had a bunch and I'm like, what is this? And he introduced me to it. I fell in love, but I slowed our roll because we had our son. Yeah. I'm a mom, and that there's a big stigma to parents that smoke weed. Yeah. Really huge. My son is about to be 10 years old and he is fine. I am fine. I was able to graduate college as he was in school. So it's never been getting in the way of anything. If anything, sativas make me super, super productive. Before I bake, you best believe I have a bowl of Blue Dream all the time. I have at least tried, I want to say 30 strains in the last 6 years of Blue Dream. Every shop I go to, I have to try the Blue Dream because no one's going to come and teach me about it. You know what I mean? And I hate that sometimes shops lie to you. You know, now they throw names around, but Blue Dream is my thing.
And if anybody ever tries to tell you that something is different, you like Blue Dream is one of those strains that you definitely know what it is. You know what it looks like. You know what it smells like. If it's outdoor, green door, indoor, you know what it is. And it's very specific. So like you said, when you're going around to different dispensaries and trying it out, you're making yourself knowledgeable in that sense that people can't lie to you.
No. And so, and they try.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You know, it's I hate that it became such a business for profit. Because it takes away from the community that is built at shops, the dispensaries. Like I said, I've been at shops for at least 5-6 years now. So I've seen the change. I've seen the decrease in value that they give to us as patients.
Yeah, it's definitely just more about the dollar signs now. And the love, I feel, is not as there as much as it used to be. And I really like the fact that you're saying you weren't really out to be in dispensaries. You really want to have patient relationships, on a personal level, which in any industry is great because in order to be successful, you really want to have that interaction with your customer base, not the people that are supplying your customers. So I think that's really awesome.
Exactly. That's exactly what I go for, patient relations, because even like nowadays, everyone tests everything, milligrams this, milligrams that. For my edibles, I do the U-test. You take it and you let me know how you felt.
that's awesome. True, because everybody's body chemistry is different. They, you know, I can take a 1,000-milligram edible and still walk around, opposed to some people I know that would throw up and pass out.
That's exactly what I tell people all the time. The five of us can sit here and have 100 milligrams, and it's going to hit each of us differently because we have a different metabolism. So it makes no sense to me for me to tell you, here's 100 milligrams, and it's not going to do anything to you. I'd rather you not know. You take it, you feel it, and you're going to feel it at one level or another. And they say, hey, you know what? I need it stronger. Or, hey, you know what? It was way too much. So then I customize it. And this person needs less. This person needs more. And from then on, that's what I do for you. You know, there's my standard. Everyone takes my standard. And then it gets personalized to your taste. And I love that.
And that's good, too, because I feel like as people, whenever we see, you know, a milligram or a dosage on something, we're like, ooh, I know I can take that and be fine. So you play it down in your head.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, I'm not even that high. And
yeah,
I hate that. Like,
it definitely won't hit you at that point.
It's like double dose and like there's no standard. You don't know like if that's going to hit you at all. Like I have a very fast metabolism. So I don't know. I feel like edibles don't really hit me as hard as they hit a lot of people. And it's like when they tell me, oh, this is like triple dose or whatever, that like doesn't mean anything to me. It's like a buzzword.
And you're my favorite type of patient. My favorite, the one that says, I can never feel edibles. Oh, edibles, I've tried them, but I love you guys. I love you guys. My goal is every single time to get you so messed up and be like, oh my God, you're edibles. Yes, I swear. And I have so many of those stories. Oh, I love it. That's awesome. You're my favorite, I swear.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Now, maybe, who knows,
Hopefully, you'll let me know later.
Yeah,
the U-test.
Yeah,
exactly.
I just brain farted.
Oh, it's all good.
I just had a massive headache.
That's supposed to happen after Bobombitez, not before
it. I'm so sorry. Your edibles are just so good. Now, I met you at the Kush Expo, right? Mm-hmm. And this show is really about helping stoners get further in their life.
Right.
So how did you get yourself into the industry? How did you kind of maneuver around? Can you tell people how to get into it?
Let's see. Let me go back 4 years ago. It started, like I said, home-based. It started with classmates, people that I knew, friends, people that were afraid to try somebody else's edibles because of the fear of what's in it. You know what I mean? And then from there, honestly, Instagram. Wow. Everything.
The power of social media.
Oh, yeah. I swear. Everything is... It started with Instagram, and then I started sharing on my Facebook. Then I make a Facebook page. Everything is, on my part, is social media-based.
And I think with social media being such a, I guess like a launcher for self-starters, they can feel and see the love that you put in. So if you're willing, I think, as a business owner to put in the work, I think nowadays you'll be appreciated for it.
Yeah.
And your customer base will grow on its own.
Yeah, I love that. I love, you know, when I first started, like, to me, every like is special. Every person that follows me, I'm like, oh my God, how exciting. Like, I really appreciate all the love because it is very hard to start something out of nothing. And that's really what I did. It was nothing. And I was okay with it being so small based. And then I just started sharing pictures and hashtags are life.
And I like that you said it started at nothing, because I feel in this day and age, everybody has an expectation to start a business and have it be a $1 million business week. And in order to start something, it's literally a startup. You have to build it from the ground up. It takes time. You may not even see profits until 6 months down the road.
Much more, dude.
Yeah, and honestly, I can tell you that the profit is extra. You feel me? Like, yeah. I know my goal, what I am on the path to do, is have my own 420 bakery. That's awesome. From being a dispensary to, I want you to come in. You're going to sit down and you're going to pick your little thing.
November 8th. I cannot stress it enough. November 8th, people. Make her dream come true.
Kush Expo 2 is coming back for that weekend.
Is it November 8th? Because that's my birthday. And if we could get that to happen.
Make that birthday wish. Yeah, we're having Kush Expo 2. Again, being promoted by the same group that did it last time. And it's very, very focused on the elections. They're doing a big thing because we're all hoping and praying and voting to make a change and make it recreational. Now, with that said, I've been in Washington. I tried to relocate to Washington to start my bakery out there. And with the new laws, a lot of regulation comes into play. A lot of things change. I went into a few legal shops, and as beautiful as they were and as big and packaging this and that, I did not like that we could no longer smell our meds. You had to look at it. Yes.
Everything's already vacuum
sealed. They don't tell you any of that. It's literally like walking into a liquor store. You got to know your liquor in order to be able to pick something.
That takes away a huge aspect of it.
Oh, of course. And here we go back to me knowing my blue dream, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm looking at a huge warehouse, maybe bigger than this, and everything from top to bottom is meds. But everything is packaged. Beautiful packaging, different type of packaging, but I can't smell anything. So what do? I go for the blue dream that I know.
You know, that's interesting, because have you been to San Francisco? I'm sure you have.
Yes, I have.
It's crazy. Their eighths come in jars. And I feel that the reason why, and I might be wrong, please, you know, if I'm wrong, please let them know what's up. But I feel like the jars, they really use that as a way to say, hey, this is genuine to this grower. Because I was watching a WeTuber, and he was saying that he went to a dispensary in Beverly Hills and was like, and they were like, oh, we got the Khalifa Kush. Mm-hmm. And when he got the Khalifa Kush, he found out that Khalifa Kush hadn't come out to Cali just yet. So I don't know, like you're saying.
They play with names, like, a lot. They really do play with names. And here, the regulation in Washington as well is you need to have the date of harvest, you need to have the date of packaging, you need to have the THC content, and we go back to the labeling, back to milligrams. I know Blue Dream. Mm-hmm. I was disappointed in what I got. And on top of it, here you are vacuum sealing, and I found a hair between my bud. Mm-hmm. In my really? Vacuum sealed bud. Like,
I would have taken that back.
Mm. Exactly.
Give me 4 extra grams of that.
You know, so it scares me a little for things to get legal and be the same way. So I'm hoping that we're a lot more flexible with our laws, because the other thing too is my bakery would have never worked out there. Why? Because the law is it has to be packaged. It has to be packaged a certain way. And my dream overall is you're going to walk in like a bakery, like a donut shop, like sprinkles of weed.
That's awesome.
You know what I mean? I want you to come in, pick, sit, eat, and then go home. That's what I'm going for. So it happened as in the last 4 years that I've been working, that's what I've been working towards. That's why my brand became more important than being at dispensaries, because I want you to remember me and be like, oh my God, I remember her humble starts and look at me now. Like, I want everyone to share that experience with me, not just me myself, but everybody that has helped me, because a lot of edibles came up to put me through school. We all know the financial aid game. Sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't. So when I need to pay for books, when I need to pay for supplies, promote on Instagram, promote to the people I know. And that's really what put me through college. And I have to thank the people. There's a specific person that has helped me every single year. Even when I tried relocating to Washington, I did a fundraiser for that too. And everyone has been behind me and helped me. And I love that they're still behind me now. I really appreciate everything they've done.
So you're basically a bona fide hustler.
Yes, I am.
I salute you, ma'am. Thank I salute you. You. I'm on that path as well. It's a path that not many can take. Yes. And
Blue Dream helps every step.
I'm more of an OG Kush type of person.
Okay.
But I have like a lot of respect for you. It's Thank awesome. You. Yeah.
That's what I love bringing to you guys. I love bringing people who are advance in knowledge that can spread it to you guys. So, you know, we're gonna take a quick break, pick your brain while we're on break, and, you know, figure out better questions to ask.
Okay, sounds good.
So right now we're gonna listen to some Nas featuring Damian Marley. It's called Patience.
I hope you need that when you're a bona fide hustler.
That's what's up. Listen to her. All right, so here we go. Bah.
Here we are. Right here is for the people. Egyptian mummies on a flag of a moon, and can't find food for the starving tummies. Pay no mind to the youths, cause it's not like the future depends on it. We'll save the animals in the zoo, cause the chimpanzee them a make big money. This is how the media pillages, on TV the picture is savages and villages, and the scientists still can't explain the pyramids. Evangelists making a living on the videos of ribs of the little kids, stereotyping the image of the images, and this is what the image is. You buy a khaki pants and all of a sudden you a say a Indiana Jones. And I tip out the gold and tip out the scrolls and even the bird bones. Some of the worst paparazzi I've ever seen and I've ever known. Put the words on this place that the world can see, and that's all I will ever show. So the ones in the west will never move east and feel like it'll be at home. Get tricked by the beast, but the way them a go flee when the monster is fully grown. Salamonic lineage where them still can't defeat and them could have never clown. A spiritual DNA that prints in my soul, and I will forever own, Lord.
Yeah. Sabali, that's patience. What the old folks told me. Can you get with that? Discovering a world before this world, a world buried in time.
gets no realer. We born not knowing, are we born knowing all? We growing wiser, are we just growing tall? Can you read thoughts? Can you read palms? Can you predict the future? Can you see storms coming? The earth was flat, if you went too far, you would fall off. Now the earth is round, if the shape changed again, everybody would have started laugh. The average man can't prove up most of the things that he chooses to speak of. And still run research and find out the root of the truth that you seek of. Scholars teach in universities and claim that they're smart and cunning. Tell them find a cure when we sneeze and that's when their nose start running. And the rich get stitched up and we'll get cut. Wanna heal them broken bones in the bush with a wet mud. Can you re-science? Can you restart? Can you make peace? Can you fight war? Can you milk cows, even though you drive cars? Can you survive against all odds now? It's crazy. When you feed people the truth, you don't know how they're gonna react. Wrongdoers, people that's just ignorant, you're scared of the truth. We patient for now. Who wrote the Bible? Who wrote the Quran? And was it a lightning storm that gave birth to the earth and then dinosaurs were born? Who made up words? Who made up numbers? And what kind of spell is mankind under? Everything on the planet we preserve and can it. Microwave it, try it, no matter what, we'll survive it. What's who? What's man? What's human? Anything along the land we consuming. Eating, deleting, ruin. Trying to get paper. Gotta have land, gotta have acres. So I can sit back like Jack Nicholson, watch play the game like the Lakers. In a world full of 52 fakers, gypsies, seances, mystical prayers. You superstitious, throw soul over your shoulders, make a wish for the day, cuz like somebody got a doll of me. Sticking needles in my artery, but I can't feel it. Sometimes it's like part of me, but I got a real big spirit. I'm fearless. Don't you try to grab hold of my soul. It's like a military soldier since 7 years old. I held real dead bodies in my arms, felt their body turn cold. Oh, why are we born in the first place if this is how we gotta go? Damn. To all the wisdom and knowledge seekers of the world.
All right, everyone, that was Nas featuring Damian Marley, Patience.
That song is so sick.
It really is. I never heard that song, to be honest.
Yeah, I heard Damian Marley. Actually, no, I heard that sample. Someone was playing that earlier, so.
It just came to your head?
Yeah, it just came to my head because that beat is it's pretty bananas, if you ask me.
It is. I really want to thank Juby and Kickback because without them, my lyrical library would not be as remotely close to how good it is now.
Thank you, sir.
Want to thank you guys for that.
Yeah, no problem, man.
Back to...
Bolony.
Bolony.
I know. It's so funny when I tell people, they're like, really? You have the people that are like cool with it. They laugh, and then you have the smart-ass people like, oh.
Haters.
Like Oscar Mayer. Yes, but it's Bolony. Get it right.
How did you get that name?
My cousin, she used to clown on me. Like, honestly, when I was little, it was always either Sonia Blade or Sonia Bologna. And she loves clowning. And she's actually trying to come here next year. Nice. Yeah, so it's pretty interesting that I'm here anyway. So she'd be like, Sonia Bologna, Sonia Bologna. And then it just stuck. It's an entity. It's who I am. It's the transition of my life has led me to be this person. And when I introduce myself, this is who you're meeting.
That's cool that you introduced the childhood nickname.
Oh, yeah.
It's genuine.
Yeah.
Now, do you get to eat your own edibles? Do you ever sit back and just maybe have one or two? Too many?
Yes, I have made myself too high sometimes. Most of the time, my reaction is, I can't believe I made this. Like, it surprises myself all the time. Because I first started doing them, I used to love eating them, but they were so nasty. They, like, really, really... Have you guys ever had really bad edibles? Mm. Like,
you're strong in the taste of
the taste is too much. I remember the day before I made my edibles, I had this brownie from this one shop and I couldn't eat it. And I paid $10 for it. And I was upset because, I mean, that could have been a gram and it wasn't, you know? Mm-hmm. I chose this edible and I had to like roll it into a little ball and put it in the back of my mouth just to wet enough to be able to, no, I couldn't do it. So I was like, okay, let me do this. And it's more for flavor. That's what I pride myself in, that when you eat it, you're not going to taste it. And at Kush Expo, everybody that tried them, I always look at the reactions, right? So I'm just chewing, and then everyone's waiting for that aftertaste. And then the reaction will be like, oh, okay, there is no aftertaste. That's what I live for, that right there. So it's when I eat them, I surprise myself all the time. I made this. When I get too faded, I'm like, oh, crap, I should have stopped.
Now, this just made me think about this, because you were telling me, you know, at one point you wanted to do, like, parties and all that.
Oh, yes.
Do you do that? Do you do the...
Like candy bars?
Like, yeah. Like, what's that like? I mean,
I have yet to do a full one. I guess people aren't really comfortable with the idea yet, but I am definitely going in that direction. When I do my own stuff, I do like little sweet bars and stuff.
Were you talking about like parties or something?
Yeah. Like, you know how there's people that do candy bars or sweet tables for their parties?
Yeah.
At Kush Expo, I was promoting that concept, but all edibles.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That is awesome.
Like the person in Oregon that had their weed bar at the wedding, they needed my edibles at the wedding.
I want one at my wedding.
Yes, I really that would do. Be the wedding awesome. Of a lifetime.
Like a bud tender.
Yeah.
Wow. You know what? Instead
of champagne.
Yeah.
Like they have little jars around.
And they're wearing like a tux or a really nice dress behind the counter.
That would be so crazy if we ever got on that level that like that would be acceptable
not
at a wedding.
If.
There's already.
When.
There's
November already. 8th. When. November 8th. All about like, when.
There's already weed weddings.
Can I imagine like so dads, like a normal suburban dad, like smoking a joint at a wedding with his buddies?
I think the best part, honestly, is being able to see like, I don't know.
That change happened?
Yeah, man.
I mean, with like weddings are already like your emotions are heightened. And then when everyone's like on a good buzz and everyone's just vibing and someone's getting married. I mean, like what an awesome wedding to go to.
And nobody's too drunk because everyone's too faded. So no one's going to throw up. No one's going to get all wild
no one's
going
to say the wrong thing in front of the wrong people.
Yeah, cross-faded. Exactly. They're super out of it.
Yeah, that's true.
Honestly, I at High Times and a lot of these festivals, a lot of the times when they have those concerts, it's crazy to see like people are just like like no one's like we don't jumping around.
Yes.
That one like, thing that happened.
Yeah. We're all literally just vibing.
You know, yeah, I went to a con or whatever, an expo type deal out at the San Manuel Amphitheater, and Wu-Tang Clan was performing, but they were so upset because no one was hyped because everyone was just so stoned and just like, yeah. And they're like, come on, everybody get rowdy. And it's like, dude, you can't ask a bunch of stoners to get rowdy when they're like lit, like super baked and everything, you know? And especially with edible highs, like if you take too many edibles, sometimes you just like want to sit there and enjoy the music and hear it and feel it. Not necessarily say anything or move around.
That's so funny, dude, because like just last month or maybe even less than a month ago, Lil Wayne like left a gig at like a High Times event because like the crowd wasn't live enough. And he was like telling the crowd to get live and they just weren't having it but like, I guess weren't feeling it.
No, just, the like, problem is we're feeling it hyped. Too much.
Oh, they're feeling the blood
out,
too much.
Yeah.
And that's so crazy. If you're an artist and you use cannabis, you got to understand these people are feeling you. They're feeling your vibes, your spirit, and they're allowing you with silence to do what you do best. And if you cannot absorb that, then why are you there?
Yes.
Why are you going to take a gig at a concert? Like, we pay money too.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We're there.
And you're paying more because Lil Wayne was there, because Wu-Tang Clan was there. Like, we pay the price to be at these expos. So don't take us wrong just because you're not getting the experience you get at other places that are not stoner friendly. Because that's beautiful. Like, to be able to be at a concert, to be able to do anything and do it faded, and more importantly, like, be able to get faded as you do it is so awesome. Because most of the time, like, I've been to concerts when I gotta, like, sneak in an edible or I have to eat an edible way before, but this is a 6-hour concert. Mm-hmm. If I wanna, like, get high again or, like, perk myself up again, I can't. Because they checked. I remember one time, try to be sneaky, try to take edibles into a concert. And I was actually going to give it to people in line, like as a promotion. Like, I was literally looking out for people with weed shirts, weed socks. you know, with something letting me know that they did it, I got there too late, and then I'm sitting here stuck with like 7 to 10 edibles that I could not finish eating. And I had to, I didn't want to throw them away. So me and my friend are sitting there stuffing our mouths, and I got to a point where, you know what, let's just give these away to some random people. And that's what we did, and I got too faded for that concert. Way too faded. But 4 hours into it, my bus had come down, and I'm like, aww. Mm-hmm. You know, and I had to, I wish that I can go to a concert with my style of music where I can actually sit there and blaze as I do it. Because rap is not really my thing. I'm more like of the Doors. I'm more Spanish rock. So that's where I go. But those are not very stoner friendly.
Now, when you were there and stuff like that, that's just, it doesn't feel right when you can't get high. It just, and I'm not saying like you have to be high at everything, but there are times where
you want
to
enjoy it more.
It really is. Now, you know what, like we said, we like to get to know you. What other passions do you have?
Party planning. That's why when I started school, that's what I was going for, to be an event planner. Since I was a little girl, I would go to like, because I'm Mexican, so we do a lot of parties. We have our first communions, we have our baptism, we have quinceañeras, we have weddings.
If you could do those. If I have a daughter, I'm letting you know now. Be around.
And you would not be disappointed. I promise you that. Because the way I bake is the way I do everything. I do everything 110% or more. Yeah. I love people. I love the outcome. I love the final product of everything I do. So my original passion was event planning, and it still is, because I still do that. And that's what I love about my edibles, that it's something I do here, and then I can still do my graphic design, and I can still do my party planning. So when he said bona fide hustler, he was not lying. That really is what I am. I'm like a Jill of all trades is what somebody called me at one point. And it's true. That's one of my big, big things. Like I said, I have a 10-year-old son, so every birthday I go crazy because I love to, the no restriction of not being a customer, of it being me and my son, and he's not going to tell me no. So that is very much one of my passions. I love reading. I love swimming. You know, that was a big thing before. Now, my lungs can't handle it no more. I realized the smoking had its little, you know, effect on me, so I can't handle the distances that I used to be able to when I used to swim. But that is very much it.
Wow.
That's it.
Now, when you say you're smoking a lot, did you use blunts and all that?
Oh, no. I'm a piper. You're I a piper. Love packing bowls. I have unfortunately broken over 30 pipes in my little weed lifetime because that's just, I love glass. I love pipes and bongs and more pipes and little ones and big ones. That's my thing.
Are you on the subscriptions, the 420 subscriptions?
For which one?
Any of them, like Kush Cargo.
No. Actually, I'm making my own of that. I call it the 420 Bob Box. What it is like a little, just like the concept, but it includes my edibles. So I'll throw in my edibles, I'll throw in a blunt, a pipe, a lighter, a packet. Do you guys know what a packet is? Okay, I wish I had to show you.
Is it the thing that you put your weed in? Like
No. A packet goes on your lighter, and it's literally like a little rubber thing that goes around it, and it has a little stick, because usually when we pack our bowls, you use the bottom of the lighter, right?
Yeah.
So this little thing is a stick, and you turn it, and that's what you use to like pack down your bowls. That's what's called a packet.
I see.
So I include knickknacks like that into my little boxes, and that's what I give out. And I don't mail them, I deliver them.
Wow.
Like I said, everything is on a personal basis. Like I'm going to know who you are, you're going to know who I am. There's no mail, there's no extra third party. Everything is on a personal basis with me.
That's awesome.
I love that. All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and let her get a quick break.
Mm-hmm.
She going to get the breath back, and we can do this all over again. And she requested The Doors. LA
yes.
woman. And you know how we like to do. We like to like spread your musical knowledge. And I'm so thankful that you brought something different to the game.
Yes.
Because to be honest, I've never heard the song.
What?
So.
Damn, son, you're missing out.
I know.
You
I'm
are.
Missing out.
You're going to have to go through the whole Doors section.
Every single album.
Yes.
You have to get high and listen to the Doors
yes,
at least
he made
once.
Music when, like, for us.
When you said get high and listen to this, it sold me on the part where you're like, you just got to get high.
Yeah.
You just like literally just want to sit in your room. It could be dark, dude, and you can just be getting stoned and like stare at the ceiling and listen to the music.
Yeah.
And you'll not get visuals, but your mind opens up.
Yes.
It's weird.
That's crazy.
Some next level third eye stuff, you know what I mean?
Oh, you know, I'm all about that too. All right, guys, quick disclaimer. These are our opinions and not that of KBeach.org or KBeach or Cal State Long Beach or any of those affiliates. This is The Doors. LA woman, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Man, what am I saying?
Here, you're just going enjoy, to enjoy, just enjoy it. This. Spark went up for us.
This is your boy Eddie F. and Diaz. We're back. Everyone's in the house. We have a moment of open forum. Last 5 minutes. Just get everyone an opportunity to talk and just say whatever you want. Ask any questions.
Yeah. So, Bolony.
Yes.
What are you watching on Netflix right now?
I'm actually not on Netflix, but I am a binger. So what I just finished was Game of Thrones.
Oh, oh
I was so late to the game.
I've heard so many good things.
Haven't watched it yet?
No, I have a group chat going on Facebook called Game of Phones. I haven't watched it yet, but I've heard really good things.
Oh, yeah. I literally sit there and pack pipe bowls, pack bong loads, and just watch and watch and watch. And then I'm like, oh, wait, hold on. You have to go back to reality. You have to do some work.
I just dab out while I'm watching. It's like amazing to just get super stoned and watch that show.
What is it about Game of Thrones? Because I'm really late to this.
Everyone's talking about it. Oof, I agree with you.
I know there's a bunch of twists and turns and such, but what keeps you watching?
The twists and turns. Oh, right. Literally, because you never know. You are not ready.
It's such a turbulent environment.
Yes. And it's very... when I was watching it, I actually got a big feel of the political climate that we're going into now.
Oh, I see.
Hillary, the Bernie, the Trump. Maybe I was too stoned. It could be that. But I sort of got, as I was watching it, it was like playing out what we're seeing now. But it's all based back in Kings and Queens and then this land that doesn't really exist. So it goes into like what I think if they could get away with, they would be doing now.
Right.
That so it kept me really like caught into it. You know, there's a lot of political things to it, but it's the drama in it. The turns and the twists and the people dying left and right. Like, it's good. Yep. It's a really, really, really good show.
Yeah, and I'm sure it really does draw a lot of parallelisms from today's time. You know, the guy who's writing it, he's alive still. So
yeah. It's so crazy. It really is so crazy.
He's a lifestyle.
that's like one of the big things with Game of Thrones is it's all based off books. And a lot of people are like, I hope this guy doesn't die before he finishes the books because he doesn't take care of himself. He's like really unhealthy. He drinks every day. He's a writer. And so they're like, this guy might die. He may not actually finish it.
We only have one more season that they're splitting to two seasons. That makes me so sad.
Okay, so let me ask this. There's just one dude that everyone's just like, you have to be alive for this. Like, he's that good of a writer?
Paulo Coelho.
Apparently, everyone's just like, we got to watch this. You got to watch this.
George R.R.?
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just saying, honestly, I'm just stuck on Narcos.
What I'm watching, actually? Uh-huh. Queen of the South.
Oh, is that La Reina del Sur?
I actually watched that one already. That one I did watch on
Netflix.
Oh, wait,
there's an English version?
They started in English. It's completely different than the Spanish version. But it's really good, too.
The Queen of the South.
Queen of the South. Yes. It's good. It's good, too.
Making a Murderer? Anyone? I binged in two nights.
I started, but then I stopped because it was too much noise around me. I was like, okay, I need this to be total silent for this.
That
was
a good one. I killed that on a Sunday night.
I just watched one episode, and I was just like, man, I can't really do this right now. I don't know. It wasn't for me.
Oh, was it like too overwhelming or something?
I just didn't really get, like... entangled in the storyline as some people did. I heard that it starts off slower and it really picks up, but like
I was hooked.
I was the first too.
Oh really?
Oh my god.
What is this?
They framed this guy for a murder, dude. Like
he's from a family that's not very well liked in a town. It's a small town. It's very old timey if you think about it, you know.
From Minnesota.
Yeah. When the sheriff doesn't like you in a small town, they're out for you. You know what I mean? And he just had issues with the law and they wanted to get him because he like tried to sue them at one point in time because he was falsely imprisoned and all this stuff. And they framed him for a murder. I believe they framed him for murder. Like after all the evidence on that show, how could you not think he was framed for that murder? Like...
That's how
intense that show is. Like you're just like angry. Like why?
Bob's Burgers? Anyone?
I'm all about that.
You know what? I watched it a couple of times, but it doesn't. I'm not all there with that one yet.
Yeah,
you know,
neither.
It's like I see the humor, but it's not. I guess it's maybe not my type of humor or something. I could binge on Criminal Minds every day, and I don't care if I've seen the episode already. I can sit there and watch it for 6 hours straight. I am such a binger with any show that I get into.
Does anybody watch The Boondocks?
Oh my god, I used to read the comics. I love that
show.
I'm stuck on Pokemon Indigo season. I'm watching on replay.
My son was watching Pokemon before I left.
Yeah. Honestly.
The original one.
Yeah, dude, they're my brothers are like glued on that. But going back to The Boondocks, I feel I should revisit that and definitely do it stoned. But we're coming to a quick close. We're just going to do the plugs real quick. One more time. What did you want to go ahead and just shout out all your...
I want to thank everybody that has supported me all along the way. You guys can find me on Instagram under Bobombitez, spelled B-O-B-O-M-B-I-T-E-Z. I'm also on Facebook. I'm on Twitter. You know, leave a shout out. If you've ever, ever had any of my edibles and you happen to have pictures, please, please post it. Hashtag Bobombitez. I would love to see client selfies.
All right, guys. This was High Vibes Radio. We got to get out. Remember, Instagram, Eddie F. and Diaz. I hope you guys had a beautiful day, beautiful week. We'll see you guys next week.
Take it easy.
Thank you.
Good night, everybody. Bye.
Is Sweet Sensation on your radio station. You are now hearing the future. This is K-Beach Radio, 88.1 FM, KKJZ, HD3, Long Beach, Los Angeles.
Poolside convo about your summer last night.
About your summer last night.
I give you no play. Cut.